22-30191, United States versus Weber. Good morning.
Good morning, Your Honor. Peter Losny appearing on behalf of Mr. Weber. May it please the court. I have three issues in my brief that I've brought up on appeal. I'm going to focus mainly on issue one this morning, and that's the suppression issue. When the government obtains information by intruding on a citizen's person, a citizen's home, or a citizen's papers or effects, when it trespasses on those, that is a search under Jones. Also relevant to my argument this morning is an 1877 case, Ex parte Jackson, where the Supreme Court held that U.S. mail, even when it's in the position or possession of a third party, bailed to a third party, is still protected by the Fourth Amendment. What we have in this case is the modern equivalent to that trespass that Jackson precluded, a digital trespass. When Detective Hall opened those images, that was a trespass, no different than tearing open an envelope.
Counsel, Instagram had a duty under the act to report anything that they found. Didn't have a duty to search, but they did have a duty to report. Are you contesting the constitutionality of that?
I am not, Your Honor.
So you're conceding for that the government may require Instagram to report?
Yes, sir. Yep, that's not
instances of child pornography.
That's correct. And if Instagram reports, as is their right, as their duty to do under the law, mm-hmm. what law enforcement has to do is what the Supreme Court said they needed to do in Riley. A very simple thing, something the Fourth Amendment also requires. Get the warrant. I mean, had the government got the warrant in this case, we wouldn't be here.
And the grounds for getting the warrant would be that Instagram referred this over to the NCMEC?
Yes, Your Honor. If you look at the cyber...
That would be sufficient.
I guess it would depend on the magistrate's determination, Your Honor, but it could be. I mean, that's up to the magistrate, of course, that's reviewing the search warrant application. Yes.
What about the terms of service that your client agreed to on Instagram?
Terms of service, Your Honor, in my view, are not determinative, especially in the Jones-style trespass case. As Justice Gorsuch wrote in his dissent in Carpenter, consenting to give a third party access to private papers that remain one's property is not the same thing as consenting to a search of those papers by the government. And when we look at Instagram's terms of service, and this is at SER 681, they're very clear that the Instagram user has some property right in that still. That's not given up at all. 681, Instagram's terms of service. We do not claim ownership of your content. Nothing is changing about your rights in the content. We do not claim ownership of your content. The Instagram user keeps a possessory interest, just like the envelope. I've bailed it.
But under the terms of service, he understands that he is both sharing this with anybody that he's allowed inside whatever privacy restrictions he's placed, but that Instagram, as the owner of the website, has access to it. And that means that he has a reduced privacy interest in this.
It certainly could be a reduced privacy interest, but again, under Jones, that's not relevant, Your Honor.
What do you make of, I mean, you referenced the part about ownership in the terms of service, right? But it also says we may share information about misuse or harmful content with other Facebook companies or law enforcement. So why isn't that essentially a license to trespass, if you will?
Certainly, Your Honor. And I'd start again with my quote from Justice Gorsuch that simply putting that in third party is not consent to law enforcement search.
It says law enforcement? Even when the term of service references law enforcement?
It's not consent to government trespass, Your Honor. So one of the areas the Fourth Amendment protects is my home, obviously, all of our homes. If I sign up for some service in my home, a cleaning service, for example, and maybe those terms of service say the cleaners can come and look around my home and they're going to report maybe what they find, fair enough. If I agree to those, I understand they might go to law enforcement. They might take it to a magistrate and get a warrant. But I'm not consenting to the government just coming into my house, trespassing into my house. And that's the difference.
It does have a different feel because it's not a matter that it would be one thing if Instagram told the NCMEC, say we've identified child pornography over here. I won't hold you to that, suggested that may be enough for the government to go and get a warrant. But that's not what's happened here. Is Instagram has actually shared the images. They've actually sent them over to the NCMEC, and then the NCMEC has simply forwarded them on to appropriate law enforcement. So it's not that law enforcement has been informed that your house cleaner found something in your house in plain view that may be suspicious. It is that they've brought it to them and said, here it is.
And that might be the private search exception. I agree, Your Honor, again, but under the trespass Jones theory, it doesn't carry the day for that reason alone.
But there's no trespass.
There's a
copy of the physical property has been given to law enforcement. It's in their possession now.
Well, Your Honor,
it's not your copy.
I'm going to take two parts on that, Your Honor. When it's given to law enforcement, that's when the trespass occurs. When the detective gets that in whatever form she gets it in. And the hearing, I'll admit, the factual record is a bit deficient on that. That's because the government conceded there was a privacy interest in the briefing stage. So the factual record leaves a bit to be desired on that question, Your Honor.
The factual record is deficient in which specific respects, do you think?
Sorry, Your Honor. Yes, in that, you know, where exactly were the images found within this social media?
And who had access to them?
To an extent, Your Honor, I would say later at trial, it became pretty clear that these were indirect messages, so not publicly posted, likely between two users, just like an email, just like the envelope in Jackson.
Well, what do you do with our decision in Rosenau?
Your Honor, I'll confess unfamiliarity with that off the top of my head.
Okay.
The counsel's Judge Gould, if I may inject a question, please. Could you illuminate me as to your view on the interplay between the trespass theory and the Katz theory of reasonable expectation of privacy? Do both tests apply conjunctively? Or can the court look at whether either of the tests is satisfied?
Yes, Your Honor. The answer is yes. They do apply at the same time. The Supreme Court said that in Byrd in 2018, that the Jones idea was the original understanding of Fourth Amendment violations. Katz didn't come about till the 60s, and Byrd was very clear, both now apply. And I mean, that's the holding in Byrd and certainly what Jones said also.
Thank you.
I'd like to get your perspective on the good faith exception, because everything we're talking about, we could assume you're right, and then we could then have that issue to deal with.
Sure. Thank you, Your Honor. The district court found in my favor on good faith. The Ninth Circuit cases, I did identify what appears to be maybe a difference in opinion between two panels. The case the district court relied on, Vasey, found that the good faith did not apply if the constitutional error was made by the officer themselves and not the magistrate. Later on, there was a U.S. Supreme Court case, Herring, that seemed to go a little bit beyond that. And then two subsequent Ninth Circuit cases, Artis, which the government cites, that recognizes that maybe it's not just limited to magistrate error. And then a second case, Camus, which recognized that, but again said that if the initial error is made by the investigating officer, good faith does not apply. I'd note, too, that Artis, which is the case the government relies on, in that case itself, the Ninth said, we'll recognize maybe Herring expands it, but in Artis it doesn't apply because the violation was so blatant. So my position is Vasey and Camus control. Detective Hall's good faith doesn't apply here to the search, Your Honor. The court had asked a bit more about the terms of service. And I know the government's probably going to speak about that a lot. I talked about this in my brief, but whether we're calling them terms of service or third-party consent, whatever that might be, if you're going to interpret terms of service as a type of third-party consent, again, I don't believe it applies in this trespass-type Jones argument that I'm making.
It seems the argument or the rule you want us to accept is when, you know, accessing electronic media is a trespass, and then any term of service doesn't give law enforcement any right to receive the information from a private company. I mean, I don't see much wiggle room in your position there, and that may be fine if that's your position, but I just want to see if that's what you're arguing.
Sure, Your Honor. I do think terms of service are truly irrelevant to this question of, is there a trespass under Jones? It might be under Katz, no question. Maybe. I mean, some commenters, I quote from Professor Orr's or Kerr's law review article where he argues that terms of service are completely irrelevant. They're between a private person and a corporation, not between the citizen and the government. And in this cyberspace context, maybe I should have started with this point, Your Honor, that if this court's going to find that Fourth Amendment rights are controlled by terms of service that everybody scrolls through and then just presses okay at the end after not reading them, if that waives Fourth Amendment rights, then none of us have Fourth Amendment rights.
Well, this is kind of what I was going to see if you were going to go there, was to say, is there really no term of service that wouldn't be sufficient? You know, if you actually had people go through and check boxes, if it was perhaps even more explicit than the one we have here, that if you, you know, we can make it specific to what your client was accused of. If you transmit child pornography on our system, here's what you are agreeing to do. We're going to take that information. We're going to provide it to law enforcement. You're agreeing to that. And your position seems to be that doesn't matter.
No, Your Honor, provide it all you want. It's up to the officer then to go to the court, to the magistrate, and get the warrant. Do exactly what really said to do. It's a pretty simple way. The terms of service in this case, too, are clear that there's still a property right. And maybe that's what, if companies want the right to give all our individual information over under a Jones theory, maybe they write these differently next time and say, it's not your property, it's ours. But the case we have...
Well, one of the problems with the theory is that, at least for now, platforms like Instagram are considered private platforms. It's a private market. And you get to deal with Instagram on its terms. And if Instagram says, we're going to share this with law enforcement, I'm not sure why that isn't noticed to you, that law enforcement is going to get access, that anything you share on their platform can be shared with law enforcement.
Your Honor, I agree. And again, under Katz, maybe that's relevant. But even then, let's just for this talking purposes say that it somehow affects a property argument. Law enforcement's involvement at the time you scroll these terms of service and click OK is a future abstraction. You know, this is not a knowing, intelligent, voluntary waiver of Fourth Amendment rights that the Supreme Court requires before they're going to find some type of an individual consent to search your person, home, papers, or effects.
What if you were sending something through a private company, like you're sending physical child pornography, so physical material, some kind of a book, something, slides, photos, something, and we're going through a private company like FedEx. And somehow FedEx sort of learned that it was there and took the book to the feds. Do they have to go and get a warrant under those circumstances?
So that's U.S. versus Jacobson, Your Honor. I think those follows that general fact pattern where a FedEx package was damaged in shipping, had cocaine inside, government tested it. The Supreme Court said that wasn't a search under the private search exception under Miller versus Smith. I think that case would be decided differently today, Your Honor, under Jones. I mean, if there's a trespass on that contraband, that would be a search under Jones, a search to get information. I don't think Jacobson comes out the same way. Same thing in your hypothetical, Your Honor.
But in order to prevail, do you have to have us agree that Jacobson would be decided differently today?
I don't, Your Honor, because again, Jacobson's the private search rubric under Katz. And my argument, again, based on Jones, if private search is based on...
You think Jacobson comes out differently if somebody argues it under Jones?
I think it could, Your Honor, yes. In the sense that the Supreme Court said Jacobson, there was such a de minimis trespass on the cocaine, just testing it chemically after they found it. But I think in a Jones scenario where you're actually touching those papers and effects, intruding on them, that is a search under Jones. I think it could come out differently, yes.
Okay, I know you probably wanted to reserve some time for rebuttal. We'll have
yes,
put 3 minutes on the clock when you come back up.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you.
Good morning. May it please the court. Carla Painter on behalf of the United States for the District of Montana. No court has held there is a Jones trespass on the facts presented in this case, and for good reason. To prevail under Jones, Weber must demonstrate three things. First, the government. Two, physically trespassed. And three, on Weber's physical property. He has not and cannot establish any of these requirements. Judge Bybee, to your point, it was not government action here. It was Instagram. that found this child pornography and sent it to Nick Mick. Mr. Weber's not contesting that transmission, so we simply do not have the first element that the government has actually committed a search here. Secondly, we need the physical trespass aspect. As we know in Jones, the physical trespass was placing a GPS unit on a vehicle. Here we have information that is completely electronically shared through servers, through the internet, no physical component. And third, we have that it's not constitutionally protected. Your honors discussed the terms of service and how that impacted the analysis here. I think that that would be far more significant under CATS, but as we know, Mr. Weber has forfeited that argument, and in fact, the district court has determined there was no subjective expectation of privacy here. The terms of service are still relevant, however, to that third element. Is this a constitutionally protected area? Something akin to your house, your papers, your private personal effects. The terms of service eviscerate that notion.
So how far does this go? Because if I, you know, sign up for Microsoft Outlook and I click some button that I probably don't read and it says Microsoft can read all my emails, is that it? Can they then review my emails for evidence of wrongdoing and then transmit that to the United States government for prosecution?
Your Honor, I think that that is something that can be examined under the Jones analysis. Again, I think it carries more weight under CATS. But here, when we're looking at the physical, constitutionally protected area, these are terms that I must agree to in order to use this platform. It's also important to notice a distinction between Instagram, a social media platform, and email or mail, where I'm sending something I intend to be private, and we know that, to another person.
But wait, so that does get into the question of whether Mr. Weber was transmitting these images privately to somebody else or to some broader Instagram group. What does the record show on that?
And Your Honor, as defense counsel stated, that it's equivocal. It's not really shored up. But the district court noted that's because the defendant did not carry his burden. Step one under CATS, you must prove a subjective expectation of privacy. That's on you, Mr. Weber, to tell us if this was supposed to be a private communication. But I would note in our brief, I noted at least one of those cyber tips. Again, recall there were five, along with five separate accounts. The defendant sent child pornography to 29 recipients. So I think that undercuts any argument. Of course, under CATS, it supports the district court's conclusion CATS did not apply, but further erodes any argument under Jones that this is a constitutionally protected area.
So what is your position on the how far these terms of services go? Do you think it applies to the email hypothetical, or do you think it's limited to social media? Where do you see this?
I think this court only needs to decide the case based on the facts before it here, Your Honor. But I would note, we're not relying completely on the terms of service themselves. It's the fact that the defendant knew exactly what was happening, and Detective Hall testified to that. You can see that in supplemental excerpts of the record 316 and 317. We had five Instagram accounts created over a seven-month period. Each time Instagram found the child pornography, it notified the defendant it was disabling the accounts, because of that child pornography. What did the defendant do? He did not go to a different platform. He did not go to email. He created a new account under a new name. He was essentially at war with Instagram. So this court does not need to decide if terms of service are dispositive, but if it looks at the facts here, there's no way there's an honest argument that this is a constitutionally protected area.
What does that tell us, the fact that he opened five accounts over 7 months? I mean, what does that tell us relevant to the terms of service or to his reasonable expectation of privacy or lack of consent?
Sure. Well, it tells us that he knows, not only via the terms of service, but by his interactions with Instagram, that they are making good on those terms of service. They are reviewing the content of his accounts, and they're using that to shut him down. We have that on five occasions.
Did they tell him when they shut down the accounts, we know what you're doing with this, and if you keep doing this, we're going to report it to law enforcement? Or you're taking that as sort of assumed as part of the terms of service?
I do believe that can be assumed or inferred from the record, but we also know from the defendant's statements. Recall in our brief, we mentioned Mr. Weber talking in jest, you know, if my attempt to buy porn shut down my account or shut down the internet, Instagram needs to upgrade their protocols. He's essentially making fun of Instagram for taking these actions. So again, expectation of privacy, no constitutionally protected area here, no government action, no trespass. I want to move on briefly, Judge Bress, to your good faith question. The defense is correct. The district court determined good faith did not apply here. However, the district court was not relying on the proper case law. If you'll recall, the district court said good faith cannot apply when it is the law enforcement officer's action that prompted the improper search. We cited in our response brief the Herring case, in which the Supreme Court stated that is not necessarily true. If law enforcement officers commit a blatant constitutional violation, or as Mr. Weber has argued in his reply, negligence, then good faith should not apply. But we know there was no negligence here. The defense has not argued that there was, in fact, negligence here, because Detective Hall opened the content here sent from Instagram after Instagram had represented that it had viewed these images. Now, keep in mind, this was 14 months before Wilson, before this court determined that no, in order for the third party exception to apply, we need to know affirmatively that this social media platform has viewed those images. So we can't expect Detective Hall to be able to foresee that change. We know in many cases post-Wilson, this court has affirmed such searches on the good faith principles, because it wasn't clear then, nor is it clear now, that Detective Hall needed to reach out to Instagram and confirm precisely who viewed those images for the third party exception to apply. Good faith applies and saves this case.
How hard would it have been for you to get a warrant?
Not very, Your Honor, as you've alluded to, and I think that plays into...
And in order to get a warrant, would you have had to have viewed the images and then go and get the warrant, or would it be simply sort of a status question, that is, Instagram referred this to the NCMEC referred it over to law enforcement, that's sufficient, we need a warrant?
Indeed, Judge Bybee, that is our argument. As for the probable cause in the warrant, absent looking at these particular images, as I said, five accounts, five instances of child pornography sent to NCMEC over 7 months. So this isn't something that may or may not be child pornography, even if we're not sure. The surrounding circumstances more than present probable cause. And that is, in fact, our argument. No warrant to open those images was required, because first of all, there's no search by the government. We have the third party exception, and there was probable cause absent.
What is the more common practice in cases like this where there's a report from NCMEC about child pornography? Is it typical that the images will just simply get forwarded to law enforcement, who just sort of see them and are able to open them, or will they more typically wait to open those and get the warrant, as the defendant argues should have happened here?
I can't speak to NCMEC's particular practices in standard practice, Your Honor. I'm sorry, I simply do not have the answer to that question. So the good faith exception does apply in this case. The defense has argued some of these arguments have been waived. Of course, we noted in our answering brief, this court can affirm on any grounds in the record. And if there are no further questions from the court, I'm happy to rest on our briefs.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
A few points, Your Honors. There was absolutely a government trespass here. I've never alleged that the government somehow hacked into these Instagram accounts. The search happens when NCMEC sends the images to Detective Hall to review. That's exactly what happened in Wilson. That's the government intrusion. That's the government opening the envelope in Jackson. That's where the search occurs. That is absolutely government action.
And your theory is they should have stopped once they got the envelope from NCMEC, and should, or the email or whatever it is that they got, without opening any attachments, and should have gotten sought a warrant without looking at the material, or they can look at the material? What?
No, Your Honor. If they get the, my position should be, when law enforcement gets that report from NCMEC or from any third party, if they're going to come into my home, for example, what they have to do is take that information, present it to a neutral and detached magistrate, explain their probable cause, and ask for the warrant.
I guess my question is the probable cause established by the fact that NCMEC sent it to you and I haven't opened the envelope?
No.
Or do they have to look at it first?
No, Your Honor. I guess I can't speak to every hypothetical, Your Honor, but I think if NCMEC is sending information, maybe perhaps describes the images. And some of these cyber tips I've seen, there's boxes in the cyber tip where NCMEC can look at the image, or perhaps the underlying provider looks at the image and then relays that to NCMEC, that describes what the image might generally be.
NCMEC has been held to be a government agency. This is government action. So isn't there a search once NCMEC looks at it?
I think there absolutely could be, Your Honor. Again, in this
and
case,
wouldn't that vitiate the warrant, even if the U.S. Attorney's Office got one?
No, that's Wilson, I believe, Your Honor. That if either NCMEC or the private party looks at it before the investigating agent, that the private search doesn't apply unless the government can show
even though NCMEC is a government agency set up for the purposes of forwarding things to law enforcement.
If it's a government agency, Your Honor, I don't think it really matters the difference between Detective Hall and NCMEC. Maybe I'm not following your question.
Well, I'm just wondering why what you've proposed, which is that the U.S. Attorney's Office or the DA has to go and get a warrant once they get something from NCMEC, wouldn't be violated by the fact that NCMEC itself looked at this, and NCMEC is a government established agency.
No, Your Honor, I think that the answer to that would be, in that situation, I would argue NCMEC was a government actor, and
right.
Other circuits have held that. We haven't.
So why isn't that a warrant? Why wouldn't a warrant be required by NCMEC to look at this?
Oh, I would. If that were the case, I would agree NCMEC would need a warrant, Your Honor. Correct.
So there's no way of getting there once Instagram forwards this material. The third-party reporter comes in and says, we've got evidence of child porn, and somebody's got to say, well, we have to go get a warrant before we can look at this?
Well, they could listen to what the reporter, if a human viewed it first, which was where this case started, by the way, Your Honors, but if a human at the social media company looked at it, they could rely on that person's statement as to what they saw to put into a warrant application, just like any other crime.
Well, we've taken you a little bit over your time, but let me make sure, Judge Bybee, any further questions, or Judge Gould?
I have one question for counsel. Before law enforcement could get a warrant, wouldn't they have to look at the images that were transmitted to know what they could put in their warrant?
Again, I think that's case by case, Your Honor, but I would argue no, not in all cases, and certainly not here. I mean, the government made an argument that independent source applied here, that they did have enough from what NCMEC had told them. So the answer to that is no, Your Honor. They don't have to do that. You know, it'd ultimately be up to the issuing magistrate and the hypothetical warrant, but they could rely on statements from others without having seen the images.
Thank you, counsel.
Okay, Mr. Lassney, thank you very much for your argument this morning. And I want to thank opposing counsel for the argument. This matter is submitted.
Thank you, Your Honors.